الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى today we're going to do the fifth خامس المذاهب عند أهل السنة. According to أهل السنة, the final and last madhab that is followed. And this madhab is called المذهب الظاهري. It is called المذهب الظاهري. Who is the imam of this madhab? Who is the imam of this madhab? المذهب الظاهري. So we're going to talk about the imam himself. Again, we won't be able to go into great details. So what we will do is tarjama mukhtasara, a very summarized biography of the imam. The second thing that we're going to do is nashirul madhab. Who spread this madhab? Madhab al-Zahiriyu. Who is the one who spread it? وَالذَّابُ عَنْهُ. And who is the one who defended it? وَحَامِلُ رَايَتَهُ. And who is the one who carried the banner for this madhab? We will speak about him. Who is the one who gave support, aid, and allowed madhab al-Zahiriyu to spread around the world? Who is he? We will speak about it inshallah ta'ala. The third thing that we're going to talk about is هل يعتبر خلاف الظاهرية, the ظاهري مذهب, is they differing, if they differ, is it given any weight, is it taken into consideration, or is it dismissed? Again, all of this we're going to speak about it in a very summarized manner inshallah ta'ala. And last but not least, to conclude this subject, which is al-madkhal, the introduction to ilm al-fiqh. That's what we were doing, right? To conclude it all, I'm going to speak about umur muhimma, important matters that I want you to keep in mind. I want to conclude because that's where it's going to finish, the subject of ilm al-fiqh. And we will be starting a madkhal to what? Al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya and a madkhal to usul al-fiqh. Lakin fiqh, we're going to conclude with the fourth point here, which is umur muhimma, important things that I want all of you to take on board, which is al-amr al-awwal. The first thing is al-maktabatul musaghara, a small library, helping each and every one of you to establish and to make a library. And what books should you place in that library? Fiqh books we're talking about. What are the essential books in fiqh that need to be in your library? If you want to, inshallah ta'ala, be able to look more into the knowledge of fiqh. We did speak about madhab al-imam Abu Hanifa and al-imam Malik and al-imam Shafi'i and al-imam Ahmed in great details. And we spoke about the books in each madhab. But this section, we will be speaking in a holistic way. Books in general, whatever madhab they are, those that should be in your library that could aid you inshallah ta'ala if you want to look at matters of fiqh in great details. Al-amru thani, the second matter that we want to speak about is كيف تخطط. How do you inshallah ta'ala schedule and how do you plan out لتكون فقيها, to be a jurist? You want to be a faqih. How? What are the practical steps that you need to take? There are four points that I write on the board. The four points are awwalul fiqh, brothers. The first fiqh, the source in which fiqh is taken from. The manba, the source of fiqh, and the key of all barakah, the key to all blessings, blossoms, and good. وَأَسَاسُ الْخَيْرِ is to strive. in memorizing the Qur'an. You find a lot of people, they're very heedless when it comes to the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and memorizing it, and giving it importance. And so somehow they think they can be a faqih, or they can be, but they don't want to take the path which those scholars took. Remember when we took the biography of Imam Abu Hanifa, and Imam Malik, and Imam Shafi, and Imam Ahmed? Did they memorize the Qur'an? That's the first thing that we said in each and every one of their biographies. Are we all together, brothers? So you should memorize the Qur'an and give importance to the Qur'an. That's the first. The second point, inshallah ta'ala, is that you strive to do what? To read books of the Sunnah. And what we mean here is Dawaween al-Sunnah. We mean books that scholars have written, such as Imam al-Bukhari Sahih, Imam Muslim, Imam Malik's Muwatta, Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, An-Nasa'i, those books. And here I said لَا سِيَّمَ أَحَادِيثُ الْأَحْكَامِ. Because you want to be a faqih, you have to give more importance to the books that deal with أحاديث الأحكام. And an example for that is the book عُمْدَةُ الْأَحْكَامِ and بُلُوغُ الْمَرَامِ. The person should look at those books a lot. خَاسَةً كِتَاب بُلُوغُ الْمَرَامِ. Once you finish reading بُلُوغُ الْمَرَامِ with one sharah, then try to read another sharah, and another sharah, and another sharah. Each sharah does not suffice you from the other. Are we all together? And we'll speak about that in more details. Last but not least, place yourself a khitta which is sahiha, a methodology, a path which is correct. And of course, what I mean here is a person cannot set himself the curriculum. Are we all together? فَمَا حَوَى الْغَايَةُ فِي أَلْفِ سَنَةِ شَخْصٌ فَخُذْ مِنْ كُلِّ فَنٍ أَحْسَنَ بِحِفْظِ مَتْنٍ جَامِعٍ لِلْرَاجِحِ تَأْخُذُهُ عَلَى مُفِيدٍ نَاصِحِ. You have to take it to a scholar, a righteous, noble, knowledgeable individual who has the knowledge and is grounded, and he will set you this curriculum. He will set you it. You start with it. Remember when we spoke about Madhab al-Imam al-Shafi'i, the person will study Matn Abi Shuja'. Once they finish the Matn Abi Shuja', then the person goes for Yaqut al-Nafis, and then al-Zubad, and then Umdat al-Salik wa Uddat al-Nasik by Ibn al-Naqib al-Misri, and then the person goes for Kitab al-Minhaj by Imam al-Nawi, بهذا الترتيب. And the Hanabila, they have that. And the Malikiya have it. And the Hanaf have it. We mention each and every one of them. Each book, you will study it. And if you can memorize it, then you're of great benefit for the Ummah. If you can memorize these books, you will come with what? With great benefit. For example, if somebody memorized the Zad al-Mustaqni', a person memorizes that. And they also memorize Bulugh al-Maram. Both, they have the evidence, and they have the mas'ala organized. That person comes out with great fiqh. That's if he's studying the madhab of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah ta'ala. If a person is studying madhab al-Shafi'iyya, if he memorizes Kitab al-Minhaj by Imam al-Nawi, and then he memorizes Bulugh al-Maram, are we all together, brothers? He has the masail, he has the issues organized in order, and he also has the ahadith and the evidence that he needs to use. But that's after he studied these books with scholars. Hifd by itself is not of benefit. Knowledge stands on two things, al-fahmu wal-hifdu. The person memorizes and the person understands. Last but not least is that path, you follow it by reading. The difference between the third and the fourth one is, the third one is that you're taking it from a scholar, a man of knowledge, or a person of knowledge is teaching you it. So you're taking it from them. But this one is, once you have finished studying with a sheikh, you are now a person who has studied the books. No one should stop you from going deep into the science and researching and looking into it more. And that itself has books that the scholars suggest, which we will talk about. That's inshallah ta'ala what I'm going to go through today. And it's that steps that I will be doing it in inshallah ta'ala. So the first part of today's session is we're going to be talking about al-madhhab al-zahiri, and the second one is an advice and a conclusion for al-madkhal ila ilmi ila ilmi al-fiqh. Let's start with the first point, which is the imam of the madhhab. And who is he? The imam of the madhhab is called Dawood ibn Ali. His name is Dawood ibn Ali ibn Khalaf. Dawood ibn Ali ibn Khalaf. You can say Al-As Bahani with Ba, or you can say if you want Al-As Fahani. Both ways is correct, you can say it. Dawood ibn Ali ibn Khalaf Al-Asfahani or Al-Asbahani. But he's known as Dawood al-Zahiri. That is the name he is known as. He was born in the year 204 and he died 270. He was born the year 204 and he died 270 Hijriah. Dawood al-Zahiri, fi awwali hayatihi, the beginning of his life, they say that he was a Shafi'i. He lived in Baghdad and he took knowledge from Abu Thawr. Do you remember who Abu Thawr was? Abu Thawr, Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, Ishaq ibn Rahuya, Ahmad ibn Hanbal. They were from the early students of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. And I said to you last time, if Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, or Abu Thawr, or Ahmad ibn Hanbal, or Ishaq ibn Rahuya, if they quote from Shafi'i, Shafi'iyya believe this is Qawlul Qadim. Lakin if Al-Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi, Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti, Abu Musa ibn Jarud, if they quote from Shafi'i, this is Qawlul Jadid, the view, the new opinion of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. We already spoke about this. Sah? We did, right? Abu Thawr was from the students of who? The early students of who? Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala. Dawood al-Zahiri in Baghdad, he took from Abu Thawr. And they said that he was a Shafi'i in his early stages. He went to Khurasan and he changed his opinion. And then he came back to Baghdad with a different mindset, with a different madhab, with a different legal maxims that he held on to. Dawood al-Zahiri, rahimahullah. Dawood al-Zahiri's madhab, it spread, but the scholars, they said it didn't really spread from himself because he didn't have students that took from him. Remember, one of the things that allowed some of the madhabs to spread, like madhab al-Imam al-Layth ibn Sa'ad and Sufyan al-Thawri and Abu Thawr and others, the reason why their madhab didn't spread is because they didn't have students to really take that madhab and spread it around the world. That was one of the reasons why some madhabs, it perished and it went. Some of the madhabs, this is why it went. Dawood al-Zahiri, the same happened to him. His madhab, there wasn't anyone to take it and carry it on, except one person who really gave this madhab weight and power. ولذلك the scholars, they said, رحمهم الله, لولا المحلى, if it wasn't for the book Al-Muhalla, لما تفقه الظاهري. This madhab, all of it would have perished. Muhalla is a book. Who is the Muhalla written by? It's written by Abu Muhammad Ali ibn Ahmad, who's known as Ibn Hazm. Ibn Hazm is the individual who spread this madhab, pushed it. So he's called Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri. He is the one who pushed this madhab with full force. And it became from those madhabs that the scholars saw to exist. ولذلك we mentioned a quote last week. I mentioned that Al-Izz ibn Abd Salam, Sultan al-Ulama, he said, and he's from the Ahad al-Mujtahideen, right? Al-Izz ibn Abd Salam is from the great scholars of Ijtihad. Look what he said. مَا رَأَيْتُ فِي كُتُبِ الْإِسْلَامِ I never saw in the books of Al-Islam فِي الْعِلْمِ in knowledge مثل المحلى like محلى لابن حزم. I haven't seen a book in Islam like the book of Al-Muhalla, written by who? Ibn Hazm. وَكِتَابُ الْمُغْنِي And the kitab which one? Al-Mughni, written by who? Shaykh Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudamah Al-Maqdisi rahimahullah. We mentioned it last week. Ibn Qudamah's kitab Al-Mughni is a sharh of Mukhtasar al-Khiraqi. These two books, Al-Izz ibn Abd Salam, he said, I never saw in Islam a book that has more knowledge than these two books. In another statement of his that I came across in Al-Muntadham by Ibn al-Jawzi, he said, I never considered to be able to do ijtihad. Al-Izz ibn Abd Salam, he said, I believed I was not allowed to do ijtihad and I didn't have the rights to do ijtihad until I read these two books. The first book is written by who? Ibn Hazm rahimahullah. And the second book is written by who? By Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah. Rather, anyone who reads Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim, he will realize that they are a product of Ibn Hazm. Lakin, but they stayed away from his jumud, his harshness on wordings. I'm going to break down something for you, and I want you to take this. This will help you a lot when it comes to your masir, inshallah ta'ala, your journey in fiqh. Brothers, the discussion in fiqh is the relationship between the wording and the meaning. Okay, brothers, what is it? Al-lafdu and al-ma'na. The relationship between wording and the meaning. Some of the scholars, they had at-tawassu' fil ma'na, meaning they took meaning more into consideration than they took the wording itself. Like for example, some fuqaha mentioned, and it was min al-gharabati bimakan, like it's mentioned in some of the books of fiqh, that some of the scholars, they said, if you pray at night, this is not a correct opinion, I'm just trying to show you something, okay? That if you pray in at night time, with no clothes on, there's no problem if it's pitch black and it's dark, because Allah said in the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا, that we made the dark a clothing. This is called التَوَسُّعُ فِي الْمَعْنَى. That's going too much into the meaning. Are we all together here? This is the issue. And there are other people, other madhabs, they have jumud, stubbornness on wording, and they won't go outside the wording. Like the scholars that said, the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say about the virgin? The virgin is sought, her permission is sought. Her permission is what? It's sought. And she gives her permission in what manner? Silence. She's silent. Her father comes to her and he says, I have found a brother for you, and he's this and this. And she doesn't say anything. She does not object. Her silence is a what? It's an affirmation, it's an acceptance. The Ẓāhirīya madhab, they said, if she talks and says, Dad, I want the man, they said, it's not her acceptance. Are we all together? She says, Dad, I want this man. They said, this is not acceptance, because the hadith says, her acceptance is her what? Her silence. This is al-jumudu fil lafzi. This is stubbornness on the wording. Do you see where I'm coming from, brothers? So you find in Kutub al-Fiqh the relationship between wording and meaning. ولذلك, someone who dealt with this issue in great details, who talked about it, who really built a strong bridge between the two, is Ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in. And Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, he said, this is Kitab al-Islam, it's the book of Islam. If you read I'lam by Ibn al-Qayyim, and you read the Majmu' al-Fatawa by Ibn Taymiyyah, you will realize Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim, they benefited from Ibn Hazm, but they turned away from his stubbornness on wording. Are we all together? They avoided that to a high extent. Rather, if you look at the Muhalla by Ibn Hazm, the evidences that Ibn Hazm used in issues, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah used it, but he used it differently. Ibn Taymiyyah khatta'ahu bihudu. He corrected Ibn Hazm in the things that he differed with him. Are we all together? So that's the first issue. That's the second point that I wanted to talk about, which is the person who spread this madhab is who? Ibn Hazm. وَلِذَلِكَ it's not good. And our scholars, they used to say that reading the Muhalla Ibn Hazm is for someone who has reached a high level in knowledge. Are we all together? It's not a book that a person should go into quickly, because Ibn Hazm has a way of doing things. Are we all together, brothers? He has a way of doing things. So the Kutub Ibn Hazm, it's best that a person goes to it in order to read it, in order to look at it, inshallah ta'ala, once his knowledge has become what? Grounded. And once he has studied a particular madhab, inshallah ta'ala. Here we want to now go into the third point, which is the madhab of Zahiriyya, is it difference of opinion? If the madhab of Zahiri comes with a difference of opinion, it differs with other scholars, should we give it weight? Should we take it into consideration? Or should we not? Scholars have differed on this greatly. Scholars have what? Have differed on this greatly. وَلِذَلِكَ there's a small risala written by a great noble shaykh. His name is called Shaykh Abdussalam al-Shwa'ir, حَفِظَهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَرَعَاهُ, who's a great man in knowledge and he's very good with fiqh. He pushes the view that this madhab is not considered, their difference of opinion. And he's not the first to say that. Al-Imam al-Nawwi said that before. Al-Imam al-Nawwi in Majmu', if you read, which is the Shara' of Al-Muhadhab, Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi, we spoke about this before. Nawawi in Majmu', he does not give the Zahiriyya their khilaf any consideration. Meaning, if all the other scholars agree on something and the Zahiriyya are on one side, he will say there's an ijma' in this issue. And he won't look at the khilaf of the Zahiriyya. Are we all together? Like, for example, brothers, if the three Imams agree on something, and then let's say, for example, Al-Imam Ahmed says no, the scholars will say there's no ijma' here on this issue. Why? Because Ahmed doesn't agree. صح? Because Ahmed's khilaf is given weight. Some scholars, they don't give the khilaf of the Zahiriyya weight. Whether they are on board or whether they are, they don't give it weight. There are some scholars who believe that, and from them is Al-Imam al-Nawwi. Why do they believe that their khilaf is not mu'tabar? Why do they believe that their khilaf is not given any weight? The reason is because they reject qiyas. The Zahiriyya, what do they reject? They reject qiyas. And if you go to the kitab Al-Faqih wal-Mutafaqih written by Al-Imam Al-Khatib Al-Baghdadi rahimahullah, he brings a statement of Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i. Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i, what did he say? Al-Qiyasu ruknu min arkani al-Ijtihad. Qiyas is a pillar from the pillars of Ijtihad. Huh? He died 500 something. He died 500 and something, 400 something. Dawood al-Zahiri died 270. Dawood Ibn Hazm rahimahullah died the year 450 something. 450 something. He's a 5th century. He's before Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Qayyim, he's before all of those. He's early. He's of the time of Abu Walid al-Baji and other scholars like that. Pay attention here. I was mentioning something. What was I mentioning? So the reason why Ibn Hazm sorry, the reason why the Ẓāhirīya, their khilaf is not given weight, is they don't accept what? Qiyas. And Qiyas is a pillar from the pillars of? So they're not considered mujtahideen, according to Nawi. And the only khilaf which is mu'tabar is the khilaf that comes from a mujtahid. Does that make sense? That's why Imam al-Nawi doesn't accept it. Like in some of the Hanabil and other great scholars, they see that the khilaf is mu'tabar. Lakin bishart, with a condition. The khilaf is mu'tabar if they don't go against the qiyas. Remember the adillah, the evidences in the religion, we said there are two types of adillah, right? Evidences. There's adillah which is mukhtalafun fihi, right? The scholars, they differ in it. There's difference of opinion. From that is al-istishab, biqa ma kana ala ma kan. The view of Ahl al-Madina. What else? Saddu al-dhara'i'. Al-urf. The qawl al-sahabi as well. The madhab of Ahl al-Madina, and etc. This is adilla mukhtalafun fi. Whether it's evidence or not is differed upon. But like it, there are four evidences which are agreed upon by all the scholars, which is al-kitabu, al-sunnah, and al-ijma', and al-qiyas al-sahih. And al-qiyas al-sahih is the qiyas which it's done correctly. The hukum, the illah, and the fara', all of it are intact. The four pillars of qiyas are all intact. These four, all the madahibs, the four madhabs, and all the scholars agree. Lakin, what do they differ with? The Ẓāhirīya, what do you not accept? They don't accept qiyas. As for ijma', this is mas'ala akhar, we talk about another time. Does that make sense, brothers? Lakin, because they don't accept this, the scholars, they said, this is one of the evidences. If they go against it, their khilaf is not accepted. But if their khilaf is not going against the kitab, or the sunnah, or the ijma', or the qiyas al-sahih, it's what? It's given weight. Madhab al-Ẓāhirī is built upon two things. I just mentioned it to you. The first one is rafd al-qiyas, to reject qiyas. And the second pillar that it stands on, Madhab al-Ẓāhirī, is taking ظاهر النص, taking the apparent of the text. The apparent, what is apparent? Sahih? Do the scholars only take the apparent? No, they don't just take the mantuq of the nas. They take the mafhum. Are we all together? The scholars, they don't just take the apparent of the text only. They also take what? That which can be understood from the text as well is given a consideration. They don't believe that. مفهوم الموافقة and مفهوم المخالفة and all of that, they don't take it. لكن even though they might word it some way different, they say that they don't take it. That allows us to have a quick understanding of the Madhab al-Ẓāhirī. Ibn Hazm, as you all know, is from Andalus, right? And Andalus at that time, which Madhab was common? The Maliki Madhab. Ibn Hazm is from a rich family, posh household. He's not from the scholars who studied under hardship. His father was a minister. And so he's from a... If you look at the munadarat, the debate that happened between him and Abu Walid al-Baji, Ibn Hazm and Ibn Walid al-Baji, was that Ibn Hazm said, Abu Walid said, excuse me. Abu Walid al-Baji said to Ibn Hazm, excuse me, because I learned knowledge under a candle. I mean, I was faqir, my family couldn't afford light. I studied under a candle. So if any mistakes or anything come from me, forgive me. And then Ibn Hazm responded back to him and he said to him, oh, well, excuse me. I learned under jewels and diamonds and posh life, that's how I learned. Ibn Hazm rahimahullah ta'ala, the scholars, they critiqued him for some things. From the things that he was critiqued for was his shiddah. He was a very harsh person. Very, very harsh. ولذلك the scholars, they said, if Allah saves you from two things, you're saved. The sword of Hajjaj and the tongue of Ibn Hazm. If Allah saves you from those two, you are what? You're truly saved. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, he killed 120,000 people. Are we all together, brothers? And Ibn Hazm, rahimahullah ta'ala, criticized and critiqued people. He critiqued and criticized At-Tirmidhi. And he said, Imam At-Tirmidhi is majhul, is unknown. Are we all together, brothers? Some of the mu'asirin, the ba'ithin, I saw a risala doctorat from one of the jabi'at, that a doctor, he wrote that this statement that Ibn Hazm critiqued Tirmidhi is not found in the muhalla that we have today. So where's the base for this? Because the one who transmitted that was Ibn Hajar. Are we all together? The response is easy for that. The nusakh that we have, the copies that we have of Ibn Hazm's muhalla today, are we all together? They have not been complete. We don't have all the versions. So Ibn Hajar may have stood over a copy of the muhalla where Tirmidhi, where Ibn Hazm said that. And even recently I was watching Bashar Awad Ma'ruf talking about the copies of the Muhalla Ibn Hazm, because he's working on it. I don't know if he finished. He's working on it. And so he mentioned that some of the copies we don't have, that some of the scholars stood over like Ibn Hajar. Ala kulli hal, coming back to the point, so Ibn Hazm was a person who was critiqued for many things, and from the things that he was critiqued for was his self-studying. And a lot of self-studying. ولذلك the scholars, they wrote, he has a kitab called Hajjatul Wada'. Ibn Hazm has a kitab called what? Hajjatul Wada', where he talks about the Hajj of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he did more than 100 mistakes. How many mistakes did he do? In issues related to Hajj, more than 100 mistakes. Do you know why? Because he never did Hajj in his life. The scholars, they said he didn't go Hajj ever. Ala kulli hal, I watched a YouTube video recently. The Mufti, Sheikh Abdulaziz Al-Sheikh, he said, I did Hajj on behalf of Ibn Hazm. Sheikh Abdulaziz Al-Sheikh, the Mufti of Saudi, he said, I did Hajj on behalf of who? I did Hajj on his behalf. Ala kulli hal, this is the character and who? Ibn Hazm rahimahullah ta'ala. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Now, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to conclude with the last two points, which is two matters which I think are very important. The first one is al-maktabatul fiqhiyatul musaghara. How to build yourself a small library in fiqh. And what are the books that one needs to give importance to? The following books are very important that you have, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is al-mabsoot by al-imam As-Sarakhsi Ab As-Sarkhasi. We said you can say it both ways. Al-Mabsoot by Al-Imam As-Sarakhsi. Some scholars, they say it, and some scholars say As-Sarkhasi. Both ways are said. The second kitab is Fathul Qadir by Kamal ibn Humam. And the Fathul Qadir, what did we say? It's a sharah of what? Al-Hidayah by Marghinani. And the Hidayah by Marghinani is a sharah of which kitab? Bidayati al-Mubtadi by Marghinani himself. Does that make sense? Fathul Qadir by Kamal ibn Humam. It's a very good book in the Hanafi Madhab. And we spoke about the kitab al-Hidayah, right? Kitab al-Hidayah, we spoke about it. What it is in the eyes of the Hanaf. Inna al-Hidayah takal Qur'ani qad nasakhat ma allafu qablaha fi shar'i min kutubi. فاحفظ قواعدها واسلك مسالكها يسلم مقالك من زيغ ومن كذبه. That's how high that book is to them. بدائع الصنائع. The third book is the كتاب بدائع الصنائع by الكاساني رحمه الله. Also البحر الرائق by Ibn Nujaym. The third one is بدائع الصنائع by كاساني. بحر الرائق is written by Ibn Nujaym al-Hanafi. It's a good book. Buy it. بحر الرائق by Ibn Nujaym. If you get the Hafi of Ibn Abidin on it, Darun Nawadir, I think, published it. Very good. Also, try to buy the Kitab al-Muwatta, Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. The riwayah that's mu'tamad is the riwayah of Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi. I told you this before. And with the tahqiq of Bashar Awad Ma'ruf. It's very good. That's the best tahqiq so far. Al-Muwatta. All of this I'm saying, I've said it before. When we were talking about the madhabs. The Muwatta of Al-Imam Malik. By the riwayah of what? Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi. By his riwayah. Because Muwatta has many riwayat. The riwayah of Muhammad Hassan al-Shaybani, which is published. Are we all together, brothers? There are other riwayat. Riwayat Abdullah ibn Maslamat al-Qa'nabi. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i even has a riwayah on it. The riwayah that is now commonly read, and it's the last version that was placed to Imam Malik, and the most completest and the best, is the one written by Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi, and that's the one that Ibn Abdul Barr done the sharah on in his Kitab al-Tibhid. Sah? Riwayat ibn Yahya, yeah. The riwayah of Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi. Also by Mukhtasar al-Khalil, and every shuruh and explanations that have been put on Mukhtasar al-Khalil. Are we all together? Mukhtasar al-Khalil, we said, it's a very powerful book in the madhab of Imam Malik. Mukhtasar al-Khalil. Also by the kitab al-Risala by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. Al-Risala by who? Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. Lakin al-Risala, it's a aqidah at the beginning, and then after that is what? It's fiqh. So it's a big fiqh book. That's the Maliki madhab. Now we finished. The third madhab is Al-Imam al-Shafi'i by the Kitab al-Umm. By Kitab al-Umm. The riwayah of Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi. Al-Umm by Imam al-Shafi'i. Are we all together, brothers? Also by the Kitab al-Majmu' by Nawawi. Al-Majmu' by Imam al-Nawawi. By the Rawdatul Talibin wa Umdatul Mufteed by who? By who? Al-Imam al-Nawawi. Does anyone remember Rawdatul Talibin is a mukhtasar of what? Who remembers? That Rawdatul Talibin is a summary of what? We mentioned it last lesson, or the lesson before that. Fathul Aziz by Al-Rafi'i. Rawdatul Talibin is taken from the Fathul Aziz of Al-Rafi'i. And the Fathul Aziz is taken from where? It's a sharah of Al-Wajiz by Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali. We mentioned this before. And the Hawi Al-Saghir by Qazwini is taken from where? The Rawdatu al-Talibin, right? And then the Irshad of Ibn Muqri is taken from where? Hawi Al-Saghir by Qazwini. We mentioned all of this before. So the person should buy Al-Umm, Al-Majmu', Rawdatu al-Talibin, and Al-Minhaj. Are we all together, brothers? The reason why I say Minhaj and Rawdatu al-Talibin is because Rawdatu al-Talibin is taken, it's a summary of what? Fathul Aziz, which is a sharh of Al-Wajiz by Al-Rafi'i. And the Minhaj is a summary of the Muharrar of Al-Rafi'i, which is originally taken from the Al-Wajiz, which is two paths by Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. By that. Now we're going to go to the Hanbali Madhab. The Hanbali Madhab, go and buy the Kitab Al-Mughni by Ibn Qudama. The best taba'a is Darul Kutub. Daru Alam al-Kutub, sorry. Which is the tahqiq of Abdullah Turki, who is the Mudir al-Rabitat al-Alam al-Islami. Abdullah Turki, he did a very good job in the Hanbali books. Are we all together, brothers? He did an extraordinary good work. So he did the tahqiq of the Kitab al-Mughni by Ibn Qudama, rahimahullah ta'ala. Daru Alam al-Kutub. That's what I think it's called. Are we all together, brothers? And the Mughni is taken from what? The Mukhtasar? Mukhtasar al-Khiraqi. The person should also get the Al-Insaf The person should try to get the kitab Al-Insaf by Al-Mardawi rahimahullah. Al-Insaf by Al-Mardawi. Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen was said that the kitab Al-Insaf, Al-Insaf was his marji'. Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen. The book he used to look into, and he would look into. To the extent they said that Ibn Uthaymeen's Insaf of Mardawi, the pages and the words they rubbed out. This is because he used to go over it a lot. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. Also, I advise you to get all of the silsila of Ibn Qudama. Al-Kafi, Al-Muqni' Kafa al-Khalqi bil-Kafi wa aqna'a taliban بمقنع فقه عن كتاب مطول وأغنى بمغن الفقه من كان باحثا وعمدته من يعتمدها يحصلي وروضته ذات الأصول كروضة أماست بها الأزهار أنفاس شمالي. Four books of Al-Imam Ibn Qudama. Get his kitab Al-Umda by them. Very good book. Second one is Al-Muqnع. Third, Al-Kafi. Fourth, Al-Mughni, in that order. And last but not least, his Rawdatul Talibin, Rawdatul Nadir, wa Jannatul Munadir, which is summarized from the Mustasfa of Abu Hamid al-Ghazali. Are we all together, brothers? If you buy those four books in fiqh, and the fifth one, which is Usulul Fiqh, amazing. Try to bring those books into your library. And of course, Muntaha al-Iradat by Futuhi is very good as well. Try to buy that and bring that. Get the Kitab Al-Muhalla, Ibn Hazm, rahimahullah, that we mentioned. Now you have a good small fiqh library. Like in library, brothers, is not there to decorate your house with. It's not. Are we all together? Sheikh Muhammad Salih Al-Uthaymeen's library was very small. If you saw Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen's library, it's very small. ولذلك he himself said, قرأنا كثيرا حفظنا كثير قليلا وقرأنا كثيرا. We read little, so we read a lot. We memorized little, and we benefited more from that which we memorized than that which we read. Are we all together, brothers? العلم ما حواه الصدر وليست ما حواه القنطر. Knowledge is what's in your chest, not what's written in books. Yeah. So the person, they bring these books after having studied a program. I told you before, you study Matna Abi Shuja', you finished. Then the teacher teaches you Yaqutul Nafis, you finish that. Then you go for the Zubad Ibn Raslan, you finish. Then you go for Umdatul Salik or Umdatul Nasik by Ibn Naqib al-Misri, which is Ushafi'i books. And then you go for the Minhaj, all of this with the teacher. Once you've done that program, if you buy Al-Muhalla Ibn Hazm, and you buy Al-Mughni Ibn Qudama, and you buy Al-Majmu' by Nawawi, and you buy these books, you're going to enjoy it. And you're going to benefit from it because you just took a program. But if you've never done a thick textbook in your life, Muhalla being in your library, what are you going to take from it? What are you going to understand from it? The second point that I want to talk about is, and I'm going to finish with inshallah ta'ala, is كيف تخطط لتكون فقيها. How can you be a faqih? What are the steps that you need to take in order to be a faqih? What are the steps that you need to take? The first thing I advise every one of you is to memorize the Quran. Brothers, the book of Allah is where fiqh is taken from. That's the source of fiqh. That's where it comes from. Allah's words, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Try to memorize the Quran. وَلِذَلِكَ الشُّرُوطُ الْإِجْتِهَادِ The scholars, they mention. Go to the books. Al-Imam Ibn Salah has a kitab called شُرُوطُ الْمُفْتِ وَالْمُسْتَفْتِ. Any books that you read on ijtihad, if you want to be a mujtahid, the conditions that are stipulated is that you memorize the ayatul ahkam, the ayats that have jurisprudent rulings, at least, if not the whole entire Quran. And it's sad because right now you find a lot of people who have turned away from the Quran, who say our aqeedah sahih and we're upon the right path and we're upon the right way and everything, but lakin they are far from the Quran. They are what? Far from the Quran. And as I said before, brothers, the Qur'an, when it came down on the Prophet's heart. It wasn't placed in books. Ibn al-Qayyim mentions in Miftah al-Dar al-Sa'adah, the reason why the Qur'an, the first time it came, it went into the heart of the Prophet, was to show you that that's where it resonates. That's where it lives. That's where it should be. Allah said in the Qur'an, وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ Your heart. Nowhere else. Are we all together, brothers? ولذلك, when the Prophet read the Qur'an fast, and he tried to read it fast, what did Allah say to him? لَا تُحَرِّكْ بِي لِسَانِكَ لِتَعْجَلَ بِي إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا جَمْعَهُ We're going to combine the Qur'an in your heart. Allah says in an ayah, بَلْ هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ فِي صُدُورِ الَّذِينَ أُوتُ الْعِلْمِ The Qur'an is in the heart of the people of knowledge. So that's where it should be, and that's where it should be kept in. The Qur'an should be kept where? In the heart. And that's why we find a lot of weakness in fiqh because of the fact that we turned away from the book of Allah. What did we do? We turned away from the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. When you read the ulama, like Sheikh Muhammad Salih Al-Uthaymeen, alayhi rahmatullahi, may Allah have never ending mercy onto him. When you listen to his fatwas, what does he say when he gives fatwas? Ayat. A hadith. He reads them fast. Are we all together, brothers? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, if you look at his Majmu' al-Fatawa, in one mas'ala he will bring like 10-15 verses for it. Are we all together, brothers? Sometimes Majmu' al-Fatawa, you read 2-3 pages, nothing else but ayat. Aqidat al-Wasitiyya, remember when we were teaching it? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, what was he doing with some of the sifat and some of just ayat, or he wasn't sticking to just one. Are we all together, brothers? Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Abdul Wahab, his works like that. وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى So the first evidence that you need is the Qur'an. And I said this before. Anyone who forsakes the Qur'an, then he's going to forsake everything else. If you couldn't memorize the Qur'an, if you couldn't give importance to the Qur'an, then really, are you going to give importance to the statements of scholars? Are you? So anyone who forsakes the Qur'an, he will truly forsake everything else. And he won't get much in knowledge. That's the truth, wallahi, brothers. Your relationship to the Qur'an is an indication of how much you love Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is Allah's speech, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second thing, brothers, is giving importance to reading the statements and the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And many of us may not have time, and maybe we're not enthusiastic to go to Bukhari and Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i. We may not be able to. Lakin, make it your job to at least go over this book, Bulugh al-Maram, even once in your life with a scholar, with somebody. Bulugh al-Maram. Lakin, Bulugh al-Maram is read beside studying a book of madhab. Because these are evidences. Like, Bulugh al-Maram will not tell you the nawaqid al-wudu in one place. One naqid is there, the other naqid is there. Are we all together? It won't tell you the things that nullify your prayer in order. Like if the madhab will say to you five things nullify your wudu, or six nullify your wudu, or seven. You look at the seven in the order and you take the hadith from Bulugh al-Maram and you place it under each one. Are we all together, brothers? So, give a lot of importance. This book, Bulugh al-Maram, scholars have given so much love and passion to it. Every year or every now and then you're hearing a sheikh explain it again. Whenever you think to yourself, there's not much that can be said about this book anymore, another scholar comes out, he does sharah. You have Abdullah Bassam sharah. Sheikh Abdullah Bassam. You have Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. You have Sheikh Salah al-Fawzan. You have Sheikh Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan, Milhat al-Allam. You know, you have Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz. Shuruh. And I promise you, when I read each one, I get from it something I don't get from the other one. Sheikh Abdullah Bassam, for example, he's very good when it comes to contemporary issues. You know, like placing it on contemporary issues, you get that from it. And the benefit. Are we all together, brothers? Shaykh Abdullah ibn Salah al-Fawzan's Minhatul Alam is gold, gold, gold. Oh, I left the most important, one of the most important ones, Subul al-Salam, Amir al-San'ari. You see, brothers, each person, they came with something towards this book. Read it. Are we all together, brothers? Once you finish reading that, look at Al-Muharrar by Ibn Abdul Hadi. Also, Umdatul Ahkam by Ibn Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. Are we all together, brothers? Just recently, Abdullah bin Salah al-Fawzan, he done a sharh on Umdatul Ahkam. I finished reading it. Wallahi, it's gold. Which one? Umdatul Ahkam by Abdullah bin Salah al-Fawzan. What did he call it? I think he called it Mawridul Afham. Fi sharh Umdatul Ahkam, something like that. It just came out recently. It's very good. Umdatul Ahkam al-Bulugh al-Maram. If you read the sharh with a sheikh and he teaches you it, you're on a great path to fiqh. Third one is, you brothers, study a program, a manhajiyya, a program with a shaykh and try to memorize. And we mentioned those programs in each of those madhabs. You try to study with a teacher. He opens it up for you. He explains the ibarat and the terms of the author. And last but not least, after you have finished studying with a shaykh, now you go and you study more. You open the books of the madhab, you open the other books, you look into it, you go into details. Are we all together, brothers? And that is, inshallah ta'ala, two important things that I believe this madkhal should be concluded with, inshallah ta'ala. If I said anything wrong while I was teaching all of these series, any mistakes that may have come from me, any shortcomings, any faults, then wallahi it's from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka atubu ilayh.